So last year when I stood in this space, but in a different location in Australia, we gave lots of videos about what we thought we'd be working on the current 12 months that we've just finished. So we thought we'd recap on some of that and do also a similar session on what might we be working on for the next 12 months. And we'll also just capture on the number of commercial companies that are engaging through the donor company and investing in our industry, because they're seeing it as an attractive place to invest in development at the moment, which is really exciting. So last year there was a few more topics than this, but in essence four topics that we've done some work on. So some work in food safety, unmanned solutions, drones, DEXA systems, and augmented reality. I'm not going to talk about augmented reality today. There's a few examples next door. You can go and have a look at some of that yourself. So let's start with food safety. Can anyone remember a video that looked like this?
Engage, 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 engage.
So this is a piece of equipment the American military's got to really repel people without killing them. Maybe it's a good solution for the deer question this morning. In essence, it's a fancy microwave, and in some ways it's no different, but it is different than your microwave at home. So you know when you cook food at home in your microwave, sometimes you eat in the middle and it's cold because you haven't given it enough time, but then the outside's hot. So microwaves do not heat up uniformly through the distance. And the wavelengths we've got in microwaves lets us at least cook meat or cook food a fair way through. So this system that we're looking at has a different wavelength. And the concept is, for a very short period of time, 5 to 10 milliseconds, you can heat up very fast the external temperature and ideally not need denature that protein. So our thinking here is if we can actually apply this to any raw meat before we pack it, whether that be trim or a primal going into a cryovac bag, we'll be able to put out very, very safe product, guarantee it, and maybe extend shelf life for fresh offerings. This is where we're doing the R&D, so we're actually on this journey. We still don't know if it's going to work yet, but this is a laboratory in America. This actually is a laboratory that does this for laminating glass. So looking at bulletproof cars, high-speed jets and spacecraft. So that's what this facility is used for. And they're letting us take some meat and some microorganisms in there. That's the equivalent of what's inside that Humvee, and we're giving it a shot. So we're actually on the journey with that one. Drones and unmanned vehicles. There's petrol drones, there's battery drones, there's land drones, there's aerial drones, there's tethered systems like you see at sports stadiums. There's images from satellites. There's a bucket load of stuff out there. So what our role is to try and work with solution providers to help them actually deploy that know-how to this industry and make sure we get some use out of it, but also work with producers to understand why would you want one. And most importantly, and they're definitely not an example of the people we've got next door, but make sure that when someone's coming and talking to you about a drone, they're actually, or you can ask the right questions to say, am I going to get value for money from this? And the example next door of Aerodyne, and you had those guys out on the tour yesterday. So we're working with those guys very, very closely to say, if we don't get these systems to be fully autonomous in the next 2 or 3 years, you guys will probably lose interest in it anyway. So Aerodyne's a company we're working with. Some of you saw them yesterday on the farm. Our aim with that company is to make sure that whatever these systems can do for us, it's what we call a silent service. So they just go and do it in the backyard and report if they've got a problem. The other video I showed last year was a video of that image up there, which is a military device. So for the last 12 months, we've been working with that company, and they're also represented outside, HDT, to convert it into what we call an agricultural prototype.
Thank you.
This is a system undergoing military trials in the US a few months ago to try and pass their stringent testing conditions. And for last week, or all of last week, myself and a couple of guys from HDT, Kent's still here next door, was travelling around northern Western Australia talking to producers about, well, we've been able to convert this platform from military to a more of an ag appeal looking thing. What should we do with it next? So we've got lots of ideas. We'd like to hear some more if you're going next door after this. And over the next 12 months, we'll actually start to implement some of those ideas. And our plan was to have this on farm yesterday and have it here today. But we've had a disagreement with our import agency about what dirty and clean means. So unfortunately, it's not going to get here. So this thing's diesel, it's electric, can run for a couple hundred kilometres. You can put extra diesel into it and get 1,000 kilometres out of it. So we're just starting to work out how do we deploy that now for industry. You've heard a lot about DEXA. Last year, Richard announced that we were going to work with industry to roll out DEXA as widely as we possibly could. What I thought I'd do this year, just to keep it in the forefront of our minds, is just run a video on how DEXA, what DEXA is and how it's being used in the health and the fitness sector.
DEXA stands for Dual Energy X-ray Absorptiometry. So in essence, it provides a very low energy X-ray to measure three separate tissues, muscle, bone and fat tissue. And it measures those tissues down to 1/10 of a gram. So not only for the whole body, but also we can look at regional changes in composition. So DEXA provides a really useful tool to measure change over time. And that's the most important thing that we're after from our health and fitness program, whether it be a dietary stimulus or a strength and conditioning program. We want to measure changes in fat mass and we want to see changes in muscle mass as opposed to just standing on the scales.
So what are we doing with our industry? We've taken that medical system, which is common know-how out there. We've effectively turned it on its side, and you've seen an example of one of these out there with the Nutex solution. And we put some shielding around it. So that's what we're trying to roll out to this industry. Now, I did say to my boss that I was going to suggest we all have a raffle and understand what his lean meat yield was. And he said if I suggested that, I wouldn't have a job next year. So I probably don't have to deliver on this now because I won't be presenting next year by the sounds of it. So that's okay. Where are we up to in the rollout? We've got 15 plants currently costed. Four plants either have it installed or are being installed, and we've got another four plants contracting as we speak. We're undergoing some live animal scanning as well to understand can we take it from just carcass use to live animal use. And industry's keeping me honest. So we've got two committees. We've got an R&D committee and an adoption commercialisation committee that are giving me guidance on how we get this out. So we're on the journey. We're not as fast as I'd like to be, but most things aren't in life for me. So what are we going to do in the next 12 months? Here's the four areas that I'd like to cover off. So you've heard Mick and Jane talk about advanced measurement systems. I'm going to give you a couple of videos of some other things that we're working on, or hopefully working on, over the next 12 months. Connectivity has become a really, really important issue and becoming more and more important, as Jane mentioned. What else we got up there? Processor efficiency. There's no point us being really, really efficient if we lose efficiency through the rest of the supply chain. So someone mentioned this morning, it might have been either Anna or Tom, we've got to get all our measurement systems balanced and coordinating and talking to each other. Let's not drive one trait at the cost of another trait. So at MLA, we've got a fairly detailed program, and here's a simple depiction of it, to show that we're actually working in lots of measurement spaces. And what I'm going to talk about now is how can we get CT if it works out into our industry. And this is the area that CT is likely to impact: animal health measurements, eating quality, and helping us do advanced deboning tasks. So the aviation baggage system uses CT extensively, and you've got a system out there from UTEC which you can have a look at. That's a live system that's running. The aviation sector is really trying to up the ante on how much they scan our baggage. And here's a bit of an introductory video of what they're thinking about subjecting all of us to as we start to fly in the future out of America. And then on the back of this is a video of us actually starting to scan some meat through one of these systems.
TSA is testing new baggage scanners that are supposed to make flying safer. The 3D images they create also mean passengers won't have to remove laptops or liquids. The scanners use computed tomography instead of x-rays that traditional baggage scanners rely on. American Airlines partnered with the TSA to test the technology. They'll start in Phoenix and Boston.
So here's a video of meat going through one of the new tech systems. And our trick, obviously, is to work out with what we can see, can we now do something with that in our industry? If the answer is yes, then how do we make these stainless steel solutions? Because if you have a look at the system out there, it's not meant to be in a processing plant or on a farm, it's meant to be in an airport. This is a really good picture of why we've been doing a lot of work on medical CT systems, but they're not really fit for purpose for our industry. And this is a real image. This is what they do in the horse sector, to actually CT a horse. So we can't run beef animals through. We can't run sheep animals through. We can run a sheep carcass through, but not a beef carcass. And the equine guys have come up with something like this. So they're combining robotics and CT hardware to get a system where you now don't have to turn a horse upside down and quieten it down. And we're thinking if we can get this to work, and I'll run a video in a moment, we might be able to use it to actually measure marbling throughout the whole middle section. So rather than just doing a slice and getting your marbling content, measure it the whole way through that middle section. And you could do an induction of feedlot as well as in processing at grading. So here's a little video on where it's up to.
We're at New Bolton Center, PenVet's large animal hospital, and we're really excited to launch our Equimagine 40DI CT imaging system to change the face of equine imaging.
The really thrilling part of this is that we hope to be able to get these three-dimensional images in a horse that's standing. The idea is that they will not have to be placed under general anesthesia to do the majority of the studies.
From a clinical standpoint, we will literally see things that we've never seen before.
That we're not only going to find new specific abnormalities and new characterizations of those, but we also think that the opportunity that 3D imaging provides is precision.
The ability of the resolution is much higher, and we'll be able to detect injuries hopefully at much earlier stages and prevent things that could be fatal either to the horse or honestly to the rider.
So we'd be hoping to get one of these systems into Australia within the next 12 months and hopefully put it at a feedlot and give it a run. Connectivity, just very, very quickly. I think most of you might have seen an announcement we made last week or early this week to say where we really want to start engaging with solution providers and producers on understanding what the connectivity issues are and trying to help you guys work out some solutions. So please come and talk to me, email me. We've got March IT out there as one of our solution providers, but we definitely want to hear from producers that want to invest with us to solve this problem. So this is not me saying I'm going to give you free connectivity. We're looking for people that have got the problems and want to invest to make a difference on their property. What about processing? We know and we keep reading that the Australian processing sector, although it's efficient in what we do over here in Australia, its costs are high. So what sort of things can we do to impact on that cost compared to the rest of the world? If you just use this as a bit of a financial model through a processing plant, the biggest cost by far is the live animal. The next one is labour. And we use that labour to then process that live animal. And if they don't get that millimetre perfect cutting right, we lose money. We don't convert everything over to that 63%. I'm going to talk through this next video just in the interest of time, but I've got three videos coming. This is where we're up to with lamb. So we've had a really successful program automatically doing bone-in cutting of lamb. Okay, and this is where it's up to. There's three or four of these systems working in Australia, and it's been a great initiative by MLA and AMPC over the last 10 years. So that's out there, it's working. And we're just about to start, or we have started the journey in beef. So you'll see a graphic very soon that mimics the lamb graphic. We know what we need to do in beef now. We've got the first module running, but now we need to finish the rest of the modules off. So here's our beef concept. We know what we're doing now. We've got the first module deployed at JBS Dinmore, and we've got the second module under development as we speak. But this just gets us to a bone-in level. What about all those cuts where we're trying to take bone away from meat or trying to seam bone? So the third video you'll see in this series is some stuff that the pork industry's got, and I've been fortunate enough to see it in France with my previous employer, and myself and a colleague are about to head to Japan to this company and see if they'll invest with us through the donor company to see if they'll convert this pork know-how into deboning lamb and beef. And that will be the final piece of the puzzle in that boning area of automation. Once again, within the next 12 months, I'll either stand up here, assuming Richard hasn't got rid of me because we know what his meat, fat, bone content is. I'll either be able to say, yes, they're interested in converting this to our red meat sector, or no, they're not. So that's the journey we're on with them at the moment. What about consumers? Michael just showed the consumer or the supermarket of the future that exists. How else will consumers interact with our products? The photograph on the left is a device no bigger than this clicker I've got in my hand. It exists today, and consumers are using it in Europe to work out how fresh apples are, for example, before they buy it. So they're a bit of an oxymoron, they're cherry picking which apples they buy. We're working with this company to understand, are they going to deploy it in red meat? Because the thing I'm mindful of is, if consumers really use this to choose how they purchase things, let's make sure red meat is in their database. And on the other side, there's a video I'm about to play of how some consumers might actually choose to cook our product in the future. So I don't think that every household is going to have this in the next 5 or 10 years, but I want to make sure that those that have it, they're probably fairly well off, then are actually able to cook the world's best steak on it. So we're actually talking to this company at the moment about, are they thinking about integrating cooking the world's best steak and other red meat products into their offerings? We don't want to miss that boat either. And then just finally, I mentioned there's lots of companies, and every company you've seen up there is investing through the MLA donor company. Here's just an example of some of those companies that are putting their money into the donor company, matching it with the federal government, and investing in developments for our sector. So there's quite a few. Finally, acknowledgements, just make sure I'm legally covered. And just to recap, we've got lots in the pipeline, there's lots more coming, and some of it hopefully is very, very scary, because that's the place I like working in. So thank you very much.